This session is headed up, what is the OBT about? I'm tempted to say it's about 30. maybe that's not too helpful. Perhaps to see what the OBT is about, it's probably worth reading what Paul has to say to Timothy in his second epistle to Timothy, chapter 3. Because this is really, I think, what the OBT is about. Timothy, of course, was taking over as the leader of a church. And this is Paul's advice to him, or some of his advice to him, at least. 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 14. He says, "As for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." In the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and in view of his appearing and his kingdom, I give you this charge: preach the word, be prepared in season and out of season, correct, rebuke, and encourage with great patience and careful instruction. For the time will come when men will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather around them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. They will turn their ears away from the truth and turn aside to myths. But you, keep your head in all situations, endure hardship, do the work of an evangelist, discharge all the duties of your ministry. So there's Paul's advice to Timothy: preaching the word, be prepared in season and out of season to correct, rebuke, and encourage. The Holy Scriptures, he says, are able to make you wise and unto salvation. And all Scripture is designed so that the man of God or the woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And that's something of the motivation really behind us when we came to set up the Open Bible Trust 30 years ago. Three broad aims, Mike's already touched them: to help people come to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. They perhaps haven't done that so much directly, though I would suggest indirectly we have fulfilled that. Helping people to deepen their faith, helping people to become more dependent on the Lord Jesus by prayer and by diligent study of the Scriptures for themselves, rather than relying on what others have said. And I think it's this aspect of encouraging people to look for themselves to confirm what is said that is particularly important in the way we see ourselves. I remember during that time, not long after we set up the Open Bible Trust, when I was preaching in my local church, I always tended to get people to turn up the Scriptures. And if I was referring to another verse, say in another epistle, I would wait for them to turn it up. And one of the elders said to me afterwards, "Look, you don't need to do this. We believe you. You know, when you say it says this, we believe you. We don't need to turn it up." And I said, "Well, you do. Because that's what the whole BT is about. Have a look. Is it what the Scriptures actually say?" So this has really been a major focus for ourselves, this attitude of checking for yourself. So what's in a name? We were deciding initially what to call ourselves, and this idea of the Open Bible was really central to what we were about. We debated for some time as to whether it should be the Opened Bible Trust. It was one suggestion. But then we thought, no, that suggests that someone has to open it for you. So it was the idea of the open Scriptures that were important. Our primary aim, to encourage people to really get into studying the Scripture in depth. Paul highlights the problem that people eventually will not tolerate sound doctrine. It's just getting people back to looking at this. So all our material has a scriptural focus, and it tries to explore what the Scriptures are saying, either in a particular book or on a particular subject. And I think that we all feel that there is a real lack of understanding of the Scriptures in the Christian church today. And sadly, I think there's a lack of incentive to go mining for the gold that is in the Scriptures. Because I think that a proper understanding of Scripture is really necessary if we're going to be effective as Christians. Timothy Keller, when he's writing about the temptations of Jesus, he makes the point, of course, that Jesus answers all Satan's temptations by quoting Scripture. And Keller says this: if Jesus Christ, the Son of God, did not presume to face the forces of evil in the world without a profound knowledge of the Bible in mind and heart, how could we try to face life any other way? So that's something of the motivation that there is behind the setting up of the Open Bible Trust. The media we use, we've already touched on this. By all means, the trust deed says, and it talks about all the things that were the latest fads in the 1980s, you know, fountain pens and things like that. But of course, we've moved on, but we are trying to move on with the times changing. The media are changing, and that we should definitely try to move with this. How do we go about it? Mike's going to talk about what we're planning to do in the future, so I won't look at that. How do we go about it then? Well, one of the ways, which again we've talked about earlier, is to encourage people to write for us. Now, if you look at the booklet, so you see there's about 49. That's an accountant speaking, isn't it? There's about 49 different authors featured there. And if you take all the people who have contributed to Search magazine, the number is much, much higher than that. So people have had the opportunity, if they've got something to say it. And if you're studying the Scriptures at all, nothing forces you to think things through like having to write about it. Especially if somebody is going to review it and say, nah, that doesn't follow. And I'm looking at people who review my stuff and are nodding and smiling and saying, yeah, that's right. But this is the case, and it really encourages people to think through what their faith is. Because we've always felt that if we have an editorial team looking at everything that we produce, the quality of what comes out is going to be much better than it would be if any one individual just wrote it and published it. And I think we're really grateful to the Lord for the opportunities that we have to comment on one another's work. Now, if there's a wide range of authors, of course, we can't expect them to agree about everything. We can't expect them to agree about everything. So here's an option. We could have had a set up a committee to vet everybody. You sit them down, you quiz them on their doctrinal beliefs, and if they fail, oh, you're not writing for us. That's not the approach that we've taken. That doesn't mean that anything goes. There are limits over what we will publish, because I think it would be chaotic if people wrote things that were contradictory on very fundamental issues. And also, I think as trustees, we would be unhappy if people were teaching things that we regarded as fundamentally wrong. But beyond these limits, people are free to express their personal views. And this is definite policy we took. Periodically I get asked, you know, what's the OBT's view on, and some theological point emerges, and I say, well, the OPT hasn't got a view on that. Here's my view, but if you want a different view, talk to that guy over there, because he thinks differently than me on this. It was great when Roland was around, because he had lots of views that were different from mine. But it's very much an idea on fundamental issues, then we've got agreement, then anything beyond that, it's up to our own understanding. The problem we feel is that if you're too prescriptive about what you permit, then the more detail you insist on, the more people you exclude. And that's got to be a bad thing. So what do we regard as fundamentals then? Well, they're really contained within our trust deed. They're divided into three schedules: the evangelical schedule, the fundamental schedule, and the dispensational schedule. Now, the order is quite important. We're primarily evangelical. Then we are fundamental, although that word has picked up an awful lot of baggage in recent years, but we are primarily fundamental, and only thirdly are we dispensational in our approach. Now, here's our policy for publication, which is stated on all our publications. Publications of the Open Bible Trust must be in accordance with its evangelical, fundamental, and dispensational basis. However, beyond this minimum, writers are free to express whatever beliefs they may have as their own understanding, provided that the aim in so doing is to further the objectives of the Open Bible Trust. So people who write for us do not necessarily have to accept all of these things as long as what they write doesn't contradict them. So what do we mean by these three fundamentals? What are the essential parts of it? Well, as I said, it's important to take the order, evangelical, then fundamental, then dispensational. Evangelical, first of all. First evangelical tenet is on the deity of the Lord Jesus Christ, as in John chapter 20, that Jesus Christ was the Word, and the Word was God, that he was God manifest in the flesh. Now, the opening chapter of John's Gospel, of course, introduces Jesus as God. He's identified as one who was there in the beginning, who was with God, and who was God. And he's named there as the Word, the Logos, responsible for the creation of the universe. But the New Testament teaches that not only is he the source of creation, he's also the goal of creation, because Colossians 1 tells us that all things were created by him and for him. But what is even more astonishing is that John 1 says that the Word became man and lived among us. He was truly God and he was truly man. There is no doubt that the New Testament scriptures teach that Jesus is God. Many have suggested it was only his followers who came up with this notion, and it was a wrong notion. But that isn't really the case, because Jesus confirmed that he was the Son of God in the sense that God was his own Father. Not just that he followed God, but God was his own Father. At his trial, he openly declared that he was the Son of God. When Peter recognized that he was the Son of God, he praised him for it. He claimed powers for himself that only God has, raising the dead and judging humanity in the future. Anyone who says the time is coming when people will hear my voice, dead people will hear my voice and will come out of the grave, that's saying something pretty startling. So he claims powers like that for himself. He accepted the worship of the disciples and others, and at the same time he pointed out to Satan when he was being tempted that only God was to be worshipped. We've got publications on the deity of Christ. Brian Schering's got a booklet called Jesus, God and Man. Mike and I published a booklet called Who is Jesus? Looking at the deity of Christ and who he was. So the fact that Jesus was God is very important, particularly because of our second evangelical tenet, which is there, the all-sufficiency of Christ's sacrifice for sin, that salvation is by grace through faith in the completed work of the Lord Jesus Christ on Calvary's cross. Now, the scriptures point out repeatedly that we're all sinners and in need of deliverance from our sin. And the Old Testament principle is established that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Of course, the sacrificial system under the Mosaic law required the slaughter of animals without blemish for the sins of the people. But Hebrews tells us that that was completely ineffective. How could the blood of an animal actually accomplish anything? But what the system did was to point towards the one who was to come, whose sacrifice would be effective because he was truly spotless. Unlike other men, he was without sin. Why? Because God was his Father. So he was without sin, and therefore he could redeem us because we couldn't redeem ourselves. So he was without sin in his nature. He was also without sin in his practice. And because we are powerless to reveal ourselves, our only means of redeem ourselves, the only means of salvation we have is to trust in that one who sacrificed himself for us. Now, that's the gospel in a sense, in a nutshell, isn't it? Basic importance, understanding that Jesus is God. If he was not God, he could not be sinless, and therefore he could not be an effective sacrifice. But that is the basis of our salvation, by faith in his work. Booklets and other publications on this. Vicky Wilkinson has a booklet, God's Work of Salvation. Athel Walter has a booklet, That Wonderful Redemption. So we have published material on that second tenet as well. So these are the two evangelical tenets that we have. We then have a fundamental section. There are four separate tenets dealing with fundamental issues, primarily with the nature of Scripture and our response to Scripture. The first one is what we've called the full inspiration of the Scriptures, that they were written by holy men of God who were moved by the Holy Spirit. It's always difficult to define what you mean by inspiration of Scripture. We've used the expression here, full inspiration. And by that we mean that every word in the original writings was recorded as God intended it to be recorded. Some others take inspiration more as a kind of general sense. You know, the ideas are inspired, the way you would use this word colloquially nowadays. But Jesus, when he was speaking about the law, said that not the smallest punctuation mark would pass away without being fulfilled, which would suggest that attention needs to be paid to that level of detail, and inspiration is as precise as that. Of course, it doesn't mean that all our translations are inspired. Some are better than others in different aspects, and it's useful to look at the work of theologians and experts in Greek to see what the real meaning of particular passages or individual words are. So it's important to consult these experts, but not if their intention is to change the words and say what Paul really meant or he really said. So as a kind of presupposition, a starting point, we take the view that the individual words are inspired and accurate, and we build on that. And because of this, it means that all Scripture is all sufficient for our needs. As Paul says to Timothy in the passage that we read, all Scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Full equipment comes through Scripture. It's suitable for all of these things. And we've written material on the inspiration of Scripture, approaching the Bible, of course, by Mike, and Eliza Wright has a booklet called A Light Unto My Path. Psalms. And that leads on to the second fundamental tenet, which is the responsibility of each believer to live a life worthy of the Lord, pleasing him in every way by bearing fruit in every good work and growing in the knowledge of God. Our salvation is a gift of God through faith and not something we earn. But as members of God's family in Christ, we are asked to live a life that's worthy of the Lord and worthy of our calling. How do we do that? By the help of the Spirit, who applies the teaching of the Scriptures to our hearts and minds. Now, this tenet mentions the fruit, it mentions fruit, bearing fruit, and Galatians 5, of course, talks about the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. And a lot of the material that we have tried to produce has been to emphasize this need for a response. It's not just learning theology for the sake of building up our intellect. It's so that we may be equipped for every good work, the need for response. We've written a booklet on the fruit of the Spirit, 6 different authors contributing to that. And I had a booklet on the writings to Timothy, called The Making of a Man of God, which is designed to focus in on this area of living a life that's worthy. The third fundamental tenet, the study of the Scriptures as enlightened by the Holy Spirit, who bears testimony through them to the Lord Jesus Christ, is the sure foundation for the continual growth in faith, which is necessary for every believer. For faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. I think this gets right to the heart of a lot of what the OBT is about, encouraging people to study the Scriptures by opening up passages to them to improve their understanding. Now, some of our publications have explicitly got questions in them for discussion or consideration, so they actually raise questions for people to interrogate the passage and think about it, while others don't produce questions, but they open up the passage and help to explain what is contained there. We do this because we believe that a solid understanding of the Scriptures and a solid understanding of God's purposes, which are revealed there, form the basis for the development of a Christian and for being an effective follower of Jesus Christ. Psalm 119 says that the way for a young man to keep his way pure is to live according to God's word. Not just young men, but slightly more middle-aged men, and women as well. For all of us, that's the way to keep our way pure. If we don't know that word, how can we do this? So there's various publications we've come up with to help people to study the Bible. Val Griffiths wrote a booklet about his own experiences called My Search for Truth. David Tavender wrote a booklet called Reading the Bible Yourself. The fourth and final fundamental tenet we've got is this one, and it's a cracker. Whilst acknowledging the Lord's gift of teachers to his people, we maintain that Scripture is the sole arbiter in matters of Christian doctrine and practice, and that received traditions and opinions, however widespread or ancient, and however vigorously supported by men of whatever eminence, learning, and godliness, are of no binding authority except insofar as they are clearly demonstrable from the Word of God. We really went overboard on that one, didn't we? I think it's a reflection of where we came from that we really felt strongly enough to express that tenet in such detail. Church traditions are great, they are fine, they have their place. The teachings of great men and of God are really helpful, and women of God as well are really helpful and help us to understand the Lord and his ways better. But the final arbiter of all doctrine and practice is the authority that's contained in Scripture. Of course, there are many situations today which are not specifically dealt with in the Scriptures, in which case we have to take the principles that we find there and apply them to the situation. So we've published material on this as well. The importance of accuracy in the study of Scripture, Bullinger's writing on that, and also Cassido's booklet on resolving apparent contradictions in the Bible, how to approach that issue. Okay, if we're going to apply the Scripture, how are we going to apply it? Now, down through the centuries, people have used the Scripture to justify everything from anti-Semitism to apartheid, to the oppression of women, and all sorts of things. How do we go about applying the Scripture? And this brings us to the third area of our trust deed, the dispensational section. Two tenets here. The first one is the correct handling of Scriptures, that in the interpretation of Scripture, it's important to take account not only of what is written, but of whom, to whom, with what words, at what time, to what intent, with what circumstances, and considering what goes before and what comes after. And that's, of course, taking the words of Miles Coverdale from the 16th century. But what we're really saying is we have to take the Scriptures in context. Therefore follows that you have to look to make sure there's consistency between passages. What is the context in which it's being written? There are also going to be differences between passages, and these differences need to be considered and not just fudged and pulled together to make them all somehow say the same thing. Nothing interprets Scripture like Scripture, and we need to make sure that we don't hold beliefs that are contradictory or mutually exclusive. And it's surprising when you talk to people how many folk do have beliefs which are not self-consistent, that don't hang together with other things they believe. I think by looking at the context, we can distinguish the different aspects of God's purposes that are in operation at the time, and also some of the local situations into which different writers are speaking. So Charles Ozanne wrote God's Grand Design. Nathan Johnson wrote a booklet called The Jigsaw Bible. This idea of pulling it all together, looking at it in context. The second dispensational tenet we've got is this, the need to take note in Scripture of God's different dealings with men at different times and places, and in particular the change recorded in Acts 28, 17 to 31, with the resulting ministry of the Apostle Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, for the sake of the Gentiles. When we look at things in context, we discover that God says different things to different people at different times, and different situations. And I think that's the fundamental essence of a dispensational approach to scriptures. And I think people take that broad approach almost unconsciously. However, in particular, we highlight the change that took place at the end of the book of Acts when Israel was set aside and God revealed this new purpose, which Paul says had not previously been revealed, to make one new man out of Jew and Gentile in the body of Christ, with Christ as the head of that body. Again, we've published material on this. David Tavender again, The Dividing Line, Acts 28, he wrote, and Michael Penny wrote about Paul's three ministries. So for each aspect of our doctrinal basis, we have published material to explain it, explore it, and discuss it. That's the basic framework for the OBT's approach. Now what we do is we don't always write about the framework, but all our material expounds the scriptures in a way that is compatible with that framework. And the framework, to maybe change the metaphor slightly, is like a lens through which we look at the scriptures. A lot of our material covers specific passages. For example, we've got studies in various books. 1 Thessalonians by Mike, Notes on Ephesians by James Poole, Notes on Titus by Glenn Birch, some of them looking at specific passages, others looking at subjects, but always through the lens of these tenets of our doctrinal basis. So over the last 30 years, we've had the opportunity to produce a very wide range of material on a very wide range of topics. And you can see examples of it over there. And we're really grateful for the opportunities that the Lord has given us, that we've been able to minister his word to so many people. And there is no doubt that a large number of people, I think, have been helped and are continuing to be helped by the work of the Open Bible Trust. And we are really grateful to the Lord that we've had the opportunity to do this. Certainly, looking back to the first weekend when we felt it was the right thing to do, I don't think any of us, maybe I'm the only one here, but I don't think any of us expected it to continue this long or to be so wide-ranging. I remember we produced the first search number one, and I thought, that's tempting providence. That's suggesting there's going to be a search number two. I think we're 182, is it, the last one? 182. So really, you know, as we look back, we're really grateful to the Lord for what he has done, the way he has blessed this work. Will it continue for another 30 years? We're going to be quite old by then. Probably not in this form. But with, of course, with the internet and so on, the material will, in effect, be available to anybody who wants to look. The important thing is, I think the OBT has been a vehicle for the ministry of the Lord's Word. And that's really what is important and what we try to do. So what we're doing now is we're looking to him to continue to lead us in the coming weeks, the coming months, the coming years. And we are all grateful for his goodness in helping us.